Good evening. You're watching the news at 7:30 on ATV. I'm Edna Dare.
And I'm Harminder Singh. Here's a look at tonight's top stories.
Privacy Commissioner calls for tighter controls over personal data in government public registers.
Urban Renewal Authority to provide over 300 subsidized flats in Kai Tak development.
U.S. slams Hong Kong for lax anti-human trafficking legislation.
The Privacy Commissioner's Office has called for tighter control over personal data available in the government's public registers.
The office warned that misuse of such data could lead to identity theft, cyberbullying, and stalking.
The Office of the Privacy Commissioner for Personal Data has found only the Electoral Register has legislative safeguards in place against data misuse among the 10 most commonly used public registers. In its survey, the watchdog covered public registers including bankruptcies, businesses, companies, marriages and land and found inadequate laws and measures to prevent the data from being misused.
We have seen cases where there have been intrusion or violation of this basic requirement. And in some cases, we're talking about harm being done to the individuals concerned. We're talking about possibilities of identity theft. We're talking about unnecessary surveillance. We're talking about stalking. We're talking about cyberbullying, about people being profiled before they are being bullied on the internet, and people profile for exploit of commercial pursuits.
Jiang said the ideal scenario would be for legislations responsible for setting up the public registers be worded clearly.
The problem we are facing at the moment is when we apply the privacy ordinance in our control, there is always dispute about whether we have been applying the law correctly in interpreting whether the use of the data is related to or in line with the original purpose of setting up the register.
Jiang urged the government departments responsible for the public registers to incorporate necessary sanctions or safeguards into the legislations.
The Urban Renewal Authority has unveiled plans to subsidize over 300 homes that could be made available by the end of the year.
The authority says the homes will not be available for single people. Vicky Wan reports.
The Urban Renewal Authority announced today that 338 homes in Kai Tak development will be sold at 80% of the market price as soon as the end of 2015. Named De Novo, the project will be the first batch of subsidized units made available under the URA and aims to help the sandwich class, those who are too rich for public housing but unable to afford private homes. The authority said they will not accept applications from single people and set the income ceiling per household at $60,000 per month, with total assets of no more than $3 million. They explained the restrictions are put in place to allow young couples and families to purchase their own property for the first time, the authority's primary target. URA's managing director Daniel Lam added that people who have owned a property in the past 5 years, non-permanent residents, those who are qualified for public housing estates or waiting for flat allocation are also ineligible.
The green forms holders, we will not entertain their applications. But as to the white form, we have to flush out the details of how we select and do we afford any priority to certain groups. And that would be a subject that we have to detailly consider with together with the agent, Housing Society.
The total cost for the development has reached $2.4 billion, and the URA's non-executive director Wu Jiwai said the project would face a deficit of up to $300 million. Lam, however, did not give a specific number on how much the project will lose, but said selling the flats at a 20% discount would allow for the project to break even. Asked if they will continue to provide subsidized housing to the government, Lam said it is an indispensable duty of the URA if the government makes a request. In addition, 140 flats in De Novo are reserved for resettling flat owners who were affected by the Kai Tak redevelopment and other URA projects. Vicky Wan, ATV News.
Pan-Democrat politician Helena Wong says she will call for LegCo's special powers to be invoked to probe the lead-contaminated water scandal.
But first, in other local news, Hong Kong University's council is meeting to discuss the appointment of its pro-vice chancellor. Vicky Wan reports.
Dozens of Hong Kong University students protested outside their university council's meeting this afternoon. They were demanding the immediate appointment of a pro-vice chancellor. The move came after University Council Chairman Leung Chi Hong agreed yesterday to allow members to revisit the decision following the appointment of the former Law Dean Johannes Chen was delayed last month due to accusations of political interference. Leung accepted their petition and promised that the council will discuss the matter rationally. Democratic Party legislator Helena Wong says she is planning to invoke special LegCo powers to probe the lead-tainted water scandal again after the summer recess. Speaking after a radio show today, Wong said the legislature has the duty to monitor the government even though it is also conducting its own investigations. Pro-establishment lawmaker Priscilla Leung said today that although she agrees with Wong on LegCo's monitoring role, she will wait for government's results before considering whether to invoke the special powers. Happy birthday to Jia Jia. The ocean pup panda is celebrating her 37th birthday today, which in human terms means she's already 110 years old. Jia Jia has also made it into the Guinness World Records for being the oldest panda in captivity ever. Chief Secretary Carrie Lam and Health Chief Goh Wing Man were among the guests at her birthday party. Ocean Park's management explained how they helped Jia Jia stay healthy.
She has great genetics, but when Jia Jia first and Anan first came to us, we took a different approach than most. We decided to train them to help us take better care of them. So for our husbandry behaviors, we taught her first to stick her arm out so that she could take blood. This helps us take her blood sample without any stress to her, and we could do that four times a year and see how her health is.
Jia Jia came to Hong Kong 16 years ago and as a gift from Beijing to celebrate the second anniversary of the handover. Vicky Wan, ATV News.
South Korea has declared itself out of danger from Middle East respiratory syndrome.
This comes more than 2 months after the first case was reported in the country.
The red travel alert for South Korea remains in force, but travel agencies here have already rolled out discounted package tours for the country. After suspending the tours for nearly 2 months since the outbreak of Middle East Respiratory Syndrome, or MERS, around 50 groups of about 600 people will be traveling to the country as early as next week. Red is the second highest warning and urges people to avoid non-essential travel. Health Chief Koh Wing Man said earlier that he may ask the Security Bureau to lift the red travel alert against South Korea if the country does not report any new MERS cases within the 28 days observation period. There has been no new MERS cases reported in South Korea for 23 consecutive days so far. Meanwhile, South Korea has declared that it is effectively safe from the MERS, which infected 186 people and put nearly 17,000 in quarantine since May. 12 people remain hospitalized in South Korea for MERS. Speaking at a public health meeting, South Korean Prime Minister Hwang Ho-rang said there hadn't been any new cases in the past 23 days, and the last suspected patient was released from quarantine yesterday. He said because of this, it's the government's assessment that the public could rest easy. Hwang also said the government would fix shortcomings in the healthcare system exposed during the outbreak. Assistant Healthcare Policy Minister Kwang Byek-chol said countermeasures against the virus would include improvements to nursing systems at hospitals and overcrowded emergency wards to better tackle the spread of any further infection. The outbreak in the country grew to become the largest outside Saudi Arabia and has dealt a major blow to an already weakened economy as it was forced to close thousands of schools and scared foreign tourists into cancelling trips. The disease was initially traced to a man who returned from a business trip to the Middle East in May.
U.S. President Barack Obama was honored with a state dinner in Ethiopia as he continues his tour of Africa.
And the Hong Kong government has rejected a report by Washington saying the city is a hub for human trafficking. Arthur Urquhart reports.
Washington's latest report on human trafficking has ranked legislation in Hong Kong to combat the problem on par with those in Ethiopia and Iraq. Like last year, Hong Kong received a Tier 2 ranking, meaning it did not fully comply with minimum standards under U.S. anti-trafficking laws. But in a statement, the administration rejected the report's assertion that the city was a destination, transit, and source territory for trafficking for the sex trade and forced labor. It also insisted that legislation in place protected foreign domestic helpers who were cited in the report.
We've got a prescribed standard employment contract, mandatory employment contract, requiring employers to provide, for example, minimum wage, provide, for example, also certain standards which are minimum to the protection of helpers working in Hong Kong. Apart from wage protection, also, they enjoy full protection under the Hong Kong labor law, which other jurisdictions do not confer on their domestic helpers, and also, of course, medical benefits and also employees' compensation and so on.
The government also pointed out that the conviction of the employer of Uryanos Lustianingsi, whose abuse was highlighted in the report, demonstrated that laws were effective in protecting the rights of domestic helpers. U.S. President Barack Obama had a special meeting during a stop in Ethiopia during his African visit, meeting Lucy, the 3-million-year-old creature whose fossilized remains have been linked to humans.
Every single person here, 7 billion individuals, including Donald Trump, can come to this ancestry. Yeah. I don't know about his hair, but
that's amazing. So Lucy was on the chain, yes, to Homo sapiens.
Yes,
she's one of the first erect hominids.
Obama recalled the event during an official state dinner.
When you see our ancestor, 3.5 million years old, we are reminded that Ethiopians, Americans, all the people of the world are part of the same human family, the same chain.
Obama's tour, which began last Friday, also aims to boost trade with the continent after China overtook the U.S. as Africa's biggest trading partner 6 years ago. Thousands of acres have been scorched by several wildfires along western states in the U.S. In California, firefighters said weather conditions in the next few days wouldn't help their efforts.
There's a weather system moving into the area starting this evening and bringing some high temperatures to the fire area over the next few days.
Residents in the town of Alverta near Sacramento said the fire spread quickly and forced them from their homes.
Gosh, it's been at least over an hour and a half. We saw the fire coming towards our direction, and we thought the fire trucks were going to contain it because it was just like this wall of fire coming at us, and it was so quick.
Police reportedly arrested a man and charged him with several counts of arson in Alverta. They suspect he's responsible for a grass fire in the town that destroyed more than 430 acres of land. North Korean leader Kim Jong-un has attended a conference of veterans from the Korean War to mark the 62nd anniversary of the armistice. State media broadcast footage of the thousands of veterans applauding Kim as he joined their meeting. Kim delivered a speech praising the war veterans. Arthur Urquhart, ATV News.